Welcome back to Geelong and the Daily Show. We're here with Nathan and Haylee Outteridge, who are currently leading the NACCR fleet, but they've been doing really well all week, really consistent. But we're not here to talk about the racing, at least at the moment. We're here to talk about just kind of coming back from adversity and what injuries, you know, we talked about injuries in these high performance classes, but this isn't even about that. One thing that I didn't know when I came into this regatta, and I've been covering Nathan for a long time since your entry into the America's Cup, that, you know, a bunch of years ago before his first Olympics, he got in a really bad car accident. And obviously he's here and he's had tremendous successes, some of the top successes you can ever have as a sailor on this planet. So I just want to talk to Nathan and Haylee about that and see what happens, you know, when you recover from a really bad accident. So maybe just, you know, tell me what happened.
Oh, it was very simple. I fell asleep when I was driving a car. I was actually coming down to Melbourne from Sydney for an event and got about halfway down and middle of the day, fell asleep. Car went off the road and ran straight into a tree. And I, you know, woke up with the steering wheel like pushed up right in front of me, windscreen all smashed in. And there was someone there cutting the door off the car saying, "Don't move, we'll get you out and you'll be okay." And I got taken to a local hospital where they did a bunch of different x-rays and turned out I had a fracture in my lumbar spine. So L3 in the lumbar spine, had a burst fracture, and so I got flown back to Sydney where I had to wait 2 or 3 days before surgery could happen. And after 9 or 10 hours of surgery, they replaced that vertebra and fused it above and below and spent another month or so in hospital. And it was 15 years ago. It was a long time ago now.
And Haylee, Bo told me that story. He said you and your brother, you and Bo, your brother who's here doing media for the Australian sailing team, you were sitting in the emergency room and it just wasn't looking good.
Yeah, we were actually doing a regatta ourselves at the time, and so we were on the water when we found out. We knew Nathan was driving to Melbourne for his first 49er event, and our parents had to leave straight away, so Bo and I crossed the finish line and then we were told. So from then on, we finished the event, but we were we're quite young, being looked after by our grandparents, and eventually we ended up just beside the bed for about a month in Sydney.
Every day
we were down there, and Mum took the whole month off work, and our whole family kind of moved to Sydney because we just didn't really know what was going to happen, and they started throwing all these statistics at you, and it's just a lot to digest. Yeah.
Right. Now, it's kind of like a miracle to come back from something like that, and you were in the middle of a young sailing career at the time?
Yeah, like I just finished youth sailing, and you know, I was 18 at the time, so transitioning into Olympic sailing, and I'd won 3 youth worlds and was trying to start on a campaign towards China, and so this was, you know, on the drive to the very first event of that campaign, so it wasn't a good start, and it was a really just a life-changing moment, I guess you could say, not just for me but I think for the whole family. Like, I think the time in hospital for me was probably easier mentally than everyone else, because they, like the family, were the ones who were getting given the statistics saying, you know, the surgery went like this, okay, so this and this and this is probably what's going to happen now, and if it doesn't start coming good soon, the chances of this happening. Whereas I was just oblivious to that. I was high on morphine for about 2 weeks because the pain was so much, and I had, like, after the surgery, the surgery itself went really well, but then I had internal organs weren't really coping very well, so I couldn't digest food, so I went 10 days or so where I just couldn't eat anything without vomiting it up. And these guys would come in every day with really smelling good food, like
Tim-tams.
Yeah, and like fish and chips, and I'd just sit there and be like, just crawl over here and curl up in my bed.
I think he ended up weighing about the same as me, and I was 15.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I was
the same.
Dropped like 18 kilos while I was in hospital. And so, like, the day I finally got to leave was actually Mum's birthday, so it was a nice day to leave and to drive home up to Lake Macquarie, and that was where sort of the outside of hospital rehab began. And, you know, I, in my parents' house, I was living you know, I had a, my bedroom was downstairs, so they had to pull the office apart so I could sleep upstairs because I couldn't walk up and down steps. Like, I had to learn how to walk again.
Right.
I had a back brace from shoulders to hips
that and I had to wear. How old were you?
18.
Well,
I had my 19th birthday in hospital.
Yeah.
So this was through January, you know, and then I had January, February, March, April, I was wearing this back brace. Mm-hmm. And you know what, it's hot summer's day and you're just dripping in sweat with this plastic thing that had Velcro tabs. Mm-hmm. And I had to wear that pretty much unless I was flat on my back. If I rolled onto my side, mom had to like help roll me so that we could put the brace on and showered with it on and all of that. And that came off after about 3.5 months. Mm-hmm. And so then the whole physio process began. And I guess when you're sitting in a hospital for that long and you're going through this kind of very slow rehab, you've got a lot of time to just think about life and what's important and what you value and what you take for granted. And so you kind of narrows your focus down a lot. So right. Became very focused, I think, from then onwards with whatever it was. It was, if I'm going to do it, we're going to do it properly 100%.
Right.
And, you know, don't have any excuses for not achieving what you're trying to set out to do.
And that moves you on to getting to China, your first Olympics.
Yep.
In 49er.
Yep.
Who was your crew?
Ben Austin.
Ben Austin.
So Ben and I did... the full quad together. I got back into the boat later that year, probably August, September, about 9 months after the accident. And we trained throughout the Australian summer and went to our first European events and came top six in all the events, six at the Worlds.
Awesome.
And established ourselves in the AST, got good funding, got good coaching support, and won the Worlds the year of the Olympics, and came fifth at those games. So that was sort of my real introduction to Olympic sailing, and you learn what's important and what's not important and where to put your time and effort.
Yeah, and Barry Johnson told us a story. It's funny how this is all coming around. He told us a story at the closing press conference of that. He said you must have capsized or something in the last race, and someone said, wow, you must have really stuffed it up. You must feel horrible. And he said, do you remember that press conference?
Yeah.
Yeah. What'd you tell him?
I don't remember exactly what I told him, but I remember just thinking that we had come a very long way over 3 years to get to where we were. And I think that we'd actually lost the medal earlier in the week because we were in a position where we were fighting with like five teams for the medals.
Right.
And earlier in the week, we started with the disqualification in race one, and we got into the gold medal position, and then we had a sort of a couple of bad races at the end. And had we just avoided those few errors, we would have been in good shape. And I just knew that next time round, you know, they're the critical things that you don't make mistakes on. And then we went into a medal race in London with a 25-point lead.
Right.
Couldn't lose.
Yeah.
So there's little moments that happen in your life that I think prepare you for the future. You just never know when you're going to get to use them.
Right. Awesome. And I know, you know, a gold medal followed. And let's go back to Santiago Langa. When you heard his story in the last Olympics, did that kind of ring, you know, with
you? It did. You know, Santi's a good friend of mine. We had a lot to do with each other with the Artemis campaigns in the America's Cup.
About that.
So we were together through all the stuff in San Francisco. And then he got, because there was no catamaran at the Olympics during that London Games, but for Rio, he got back into it and spent a lot of time with him with all the cup stuff. And I remember we went to the Worlds in Argentina for the 49ers, you know, his hometown, and he was just recovering from his lung surgery. And I just couldn't believe the drive that he had. And, you know, we had quite a few dinners while we're there together, and he was showing us around his hometown. It was awesome. And he's just like, yeah, I just have to do a little bit more every day. You know, I might only have one lung now, so I've got to make sure that's a very good lung. So he'd go cycling, he'd be playing squash, he'd be playing with his boys all the time, you know, because they're in the 49er class. And you know, when he got to Rio, I just remember looking at him in the week and I'm like, he's just happy that he's here. He's just knows he's very lucky to be at this event, and Nathan, so he had nothing to lose.
Nate always jokes on the, like, cruising around before the start, and you know you got a big day, like three or four races that day. and a lot of our chat is about preserving energy and trying not to do anything too silly. Yeah. And anytime we're sailing around the start, Nate's like, guess who has their card up right now? Santi.
Santi acts as if he's the youngest person in the fleet.
And they're just sending it everywhere. And Nate's like, we can't do that.
I was like, imagine if you sat with Santi, Haley. Oh, she's like, God. No way, I can't do it.
Yeah, he's just like going fast all the time.
He'd be exhausted.
Yeah. Yeah.
But really, I think impressive. That's how Santi's lived his life. He's just, I need to act as if I am in my 20s. He trains that way. And he, I reckon that little episode that he went through ahead of Rio really gave him that time to sort of assess and to focus. And when it was just like
with you.
Yeah, 100%. You know, and we've had those conversations and I shared some of my stories with him. But I think during the Rio Olympics, when the points were getting close, he was just like, how lucky am I to be here doing this? Okay, I pick this shift, I do that, I win a gold medal. You know, like, you know, that year for him was incredible.
Do you think he was thinking that when he was doing that penalty circle on the last
No, hour? He would have been swearing in Spanish for sure. Me, no, I'm innocent.
So. No, but that's great. And it's nice to see. I mean, do you think about that accident? Do you think about your recovery? Do you think about any part of that?
I think maybe for the first 3-4 years. Mm-hmm. But I think the people who think about it more is probably my mum.
Right.
Every year she reminds me.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know, remember all that? Yeah.
Or anytime.
Remember how much pain you put me through?
Even when we drove down here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because we drove past the exact spot on the way here. Yeah.
A month ago we drove together, which was also helpful. But, you know, we're not allowed to do that drive alone now.
Right, right, yeah, of course.
Or any drive.
Any long
Europe,
distance drive, you're not allowed to do it on your own.
Yeah, well, good lesson though, right?
It's very good lesson. Yeah.
Well, it's been awesome to watch your career go and continue to go. I don't know if you're going to last. Do you think you'll last as long as Santi?
Winning gold medal? I'm about half his age and I feel broken after 3 days of racing you.
But he only has one lung.
I know. He must be doing something smarter than us.
Are you going to go to an Olympics with Jack?
Well, I am. Jack's now one, so if I wait about 25 years.
Jack is how old is Jack?
He's 13 months old.
So a 13-month-old son who is just walking around behind us. So
he's been helping me all week on the boat work. I bring him down in the morning and
awesome.
He checks the boat with me.
Nice.
So mum can have an hour or two break. But it's cool to have the whole family here. Mum and Dad arrived today and my wife Em and Jack have been here for over a week. And obviously we got this one and we've got Bo, so it's a cool family affair and I think we all really enjoy it.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for sharing your story. So a lot of people didn't know about this, but I think it can actually help a lot of people too.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, there are moments in life where you go through setbacks and setbacks are inevitable. Some are really bad ones. Some of them are minor, but it's about how you pick yourself up and prioritize your life from there onwards.
Awesome. Thanks so much, you too.
No worries.
All right. We'll see you on the next Daily.